Welcome one, welcome all to the Tales of Tyria. Welcome one, welcome all to the Tales of
Welcome one, welcome all to the jam session here at Tyrion Rock Studios. That brand new intro brought to you by one of our fabulous listeners. I'm going to see if I can get this right. Bjorn Langborn from Sweden. Thank you very much, sir. He sent this to me back in May. And believe it or not, every single week since then, I've been like, I got to use this for the intro for him because that was awesome. Awesome. Thank you very much, Bjorn. And welcome to Tales of Tyria, number 34, ladies and gentlemen. I am your host, Bridger, and we are almost live from, I don't know, where are we? Not the Rosewind Tavern, since we discovered that it isn't actually a Rosewind Tavern anymore. You know what? We're gonna make it happen. We have everybody moving around here. Hello! That was the weirdest intro ever. Hello, guys. How's it going?
Great. How you doing, Bridger?
Not bad. That intro threw me off. It was very different. So, how'd you guys like that? I thought that was pretty awesome.
I thought it was good.
I think the entire chat room just went ballistic. They loved it.
I think they were a little confused at like the first 10 seconds of it.
Yeah.
My immersion is completely broken. Completely busted.
Please tell me you put that up on the show notes there so people can listen to it, right?
I'll definitely put it in the show notes. I'll put it up on Google Drive. Let me just make a note of that right now. If I put it in green and bold and, like, add to Google Drive, then I'll make sure that happens. Because I'm sure we're going to want to get people... I want to take that with me on the bus. Okay, so that was pretty cool. Welcome, guys. Again, this is the Guild Wars 2 podcast. This is episode number 34. We've got a lot of great stuff to talk about. Very briefly, let me tell you what we're doing here today. We have, essentially, a lot of news this week. Some of it talking about the beta weekend event and maybe some of the stuff that you might have seen in the PCGamer podcast. Not podcast, stream that happened this past weekend, as well as a thread with Eric Flannum with some interesting sounding stuff, and a couple of questions in the mailbag this week, actually. We thought it would be a good time to do that. So we are going to take care of that starting in a few moments. But first, let me do a quick update on the whole beta key thing that we had this past weekend. For those paying attention to the Tales of Tyria website or any of the myriad threads that we had going out there or the Twitter, they will know that we had 20 beta keys courtesy of ArenaNet to give out. And unfortunately, while I wanted to give them out like live on air, they weren't going to allow that because they needed it to be done by Sunday and I was at a wedding. So one of the things I did want to cover, though, is a brief look at the statistics. So let's pop this up on the screen here. These are the responses to the beta key contest. Excuse me. Fatalist, actually, a Team Legacy member, got a lot of love from because he was the first choice on there. He picked up 11% of the people answering the questions thought that he was the frequent host of Tales of Tyria. The correct answer was great. Great is the one that's on there an awful lot. He did get 69% of the responses, so most of the people knew that Great was the guy that comes on and usually fills in for when Kai's not here. Oh, I should introduce everybody, by the way. Vega, Freelancer, and Oku's filling in for Kai today. Hello, sir. Welcome.
Thank you.
You and me rocking the awesome backdrops today.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just can't. I get away from Stone Mist.
You've got that awesome looking rug in the background. I've just had stupid birds the whole time.
I have Overseer Kitty, so I win every argument about that.
All right, so let's see. Actually, speaking of Overseer Cat, he was the answer to one of the questions in that that little quiz there. The question is, what is the name of one of the animal companions commonly featured on the show? And I put a hint on there that said adjective noun. Like, it was supposed to be in that form, because we have... can hear in the background right now. So I thought, and then a lot of people did get Overseer Cat and Background Bird, but I think that was the one that people had the most trouble with, if I'm not mistaken. We had about 70 or 80 of the 450 responses correctly guessed either Overseer Cat, Background Bird, or Sheik, which is actually the bird's name. And there was like 7 people that got that. I think we mentioned it on one show at one point that the bird's name was Sheik. So I gave it to him. I let him have that one. A lot of people went with Noisy Bird. Sheik being the, by the way, the disguised form of Zelda in Ocarina of Time. Right. That's where we got that, because the last one we got was Link. And so now this one's Sheik. All right, so
man, Overseer Cat, call your bird dinner.
Well, there's a whole internet between you and me.
That's a lot of internet.
Question 3: what breaks freelancers' immersion? Let's see. What was the obviously the correct answer was Bridger. Breaks freelancers' immersion. 75% of the people got that correct. In second place, nothing. He has an iron will. So a lot of people, 8%, thought that was the correct answer. And not a lot of love for my unrealistic inflation rates. I was hoping to get a lot of people with that one. Bridger is known for doing this on the show: falling asleep, ranting, reading lore, crunching numbers, or rapping. This is by far the largest segment of the audience knew this one correct, and that was 91% guessed falling asleep correctly. Actually, sorry, ranting. And let's see, a whole bunch of people, probably at least 80 to 90% knew which community site Tales of Tyria is affiliated with and correctly guessed some form of teamlegacy.net. So that was pretty cool. Very psyched that ArenaNet gave those to us. Huge thanks out to them.
Yes, and very much so. That was awesome for them to do that.
Absolutely. And for those of you just for who are new to the show, maybe anything that we talk about on the show here is going to be linked in the show notes, which you can find on the main website. Talesoftyria.com is where you can find it. Just search for the actual show that you're looking for, which is number 34, and you should see all the links that we're talking about here. So we've got a thread here once we jump into the news, and this is a disc mail-out by a very kind Redditor. I don't know if this is still up for grabs or not. Did any of you guys read through this real quick?
Yeah, I read that. Yeah, I mean, I thought it was really cool because I think...
Explain it to everybody, Oku. Tell everybody what's going on.
Well, I mean, I basically, I think this could be wrong. It might have been a previous one, but I think the guy's in Australia, and they have, like, really stringent requirements on bandwidth, and so a lot of people may not have the monthly bandwidth to download the beta, and so he thought, hey, I'll be a nice guy. I'll just download it and send it to you guys on a disc, just kind of, you know, getting that karma.
Yeah, I just wanted
I think it was also that and the fact that I guess their internet was really slow when it was downloading the client. Mm.
Yeah.
So he was kind of helping both people out that had slow and also the restrictions.
Yeah. I've heard a lot of problems with people in Australia where they're limited to like 50 gigs a month or even like 100 or something like that. And so if you're downloading a 25 gigabyte or actually no, it's like 12 gigabyte, expands to 12, but still that's like that could be 10% of your internet usage for the month. That's a huge problem for those people. So huge props to this guy Zidneric, and I just wanted to recognize him because he's an awesome member of the Guild Wars 2 community, willing to do that.
For free too. Yeah. He wasn't like charging anyone.
Exactly.
But
I
good for him.
I like what's the first post on here that says, I see a lot of "you're awesome" posts here, which is nice and all, but they are wrong. You're more than awesome. You're a lone soldier in the war on crap internet. So
that's
definitely.
So true, though, because, you know, we have members in our community that are in Australia. Kira, I'm speaking to you, man. And he just keeps trucking. I mean, lag fest after lag fest, League of Legends, you name it. And he's I got to give it to him. I don't know how Australians do it. And they're forced to play on U.S. servers. I mean, think about that, you know?
Yeah, that's
and everything's point. Upside down for them. It's even harder.
He went there.
Like, what is WASD in Australia? Is that like DSAW or something? I don't even know.
I think so.
I don't know. I got to turn my keyboard upside down.
I guess we'll have to find it. Okay, what else do we have on the list here?
I'm just kidding. I love Australians. Don't send me hate mail.
They're going to stick the kangaroos on you.
Oh, I love Australians.
That's no good. All right.
Australians have the best accent. Sorry, they do.
That's true. That's why they get so much hate, is because everybody's just jealous of their really awesome accent.
Any Australian guy can come to America and steal your chick. See, that's the problem.
Ooh, yeah. Everybody always says it's you know, like the Italian guys or the French guys, but it's absolutely the Australian guys. Yeah,
I mean, it's also Irish.
Oh, it's Irish. Yep.
I go Australian Irish with accents, but off the rant, moving on.
Welcome to This Week in Seduction. No, Guild Wars 2 will not be released tomorrow. This is a thread I found on Reddit also, and it's very much on point, and it basically is somebody saying, listen, I know that a lot of people have been speculating, like, oh man, it could be tomorrow, you never know. The answer is no, it's just not going to be. And he gives a lot of really good reasons. He goes through, for those of you who are not familiar with the way that game development works, I highly recommend checking out this thread because he kind of goes through all the things. I'm not going to recap everything, but he basically says, listen, based on the way that game development works, you're going to be at least something like 45 days between a release announcement and the release day. It's almost certainly going to be at least 30 to 40 days, probably more like 45 to 60, if I'm not mistaken. So I know there's a lot of people freaking out about, oh, it might come out this month, you never know. I think it's not going to come out this month. If it was going to come out this month, we would have heard the release date last month. That's the way I look at it. I don't know. What do you guys think?
I mean, you know, what if ArenaNet trolls us and just says, you know, I'm going to bite my tongue when I say this, but like just says 3 weeks from now. You know, release date. We want to hit it before summertime. Let's go, you know?
Well, I mean, you know, that happens with console games pretty often. It'll be completely unknown, and then bam, it's out. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, looking through what that guy was breaking down, like with the timelines, I don't feel that is sort of the same for every single company. I mean, it's a generalization, because the way he was kind of describing it, it was almost like a non-computer game, so to say, because they, you know, more worrying about like ship dates and all that other stuff. But now all the computer games, it's all, you know, digital downloads and everything. But I mean, they did say in the past that they don't want to release it too late. They want it out, you know, the sooner the better. So I'm guessing it's going to be out before the summer's over, but I don't know when in the summer.
Well, you remember my original prediction, if you guys remember, was that they were waiting for Diablo 3 to release because, you know, it was in my mindset that the marketing team is like, you know, we don't want to compete with the initial rush of Diablo 3 players.
No, you don't.
Well, now Diablo 3's out, and we still haven't heard anything. So now I'm sort of up in the air. I mean, are they just going to wait forever now, or is it going to be, is it going to be Christmas?
I don't think it's going to come out in the fall. I think they want to take advantage of all the kids being out of school in the summer. I think that's really what they should take advantage of.
If they
release the game September when college is back in session, all the other schools
then
in the country
are back
in session.
Then they are contributing to the death of the American education, is what they're doing, and maybe across the world. I think it has to be summer too, because they don't want to compete with all the games that are coming out in the fall for the Christmas season. You want to be way ahead of the curve. You want to be the only thing people are talking about from August until September when the new games come out, right? Or July even. You want that hype machine to happen throughout that time when normally there's a dearth of new things to talk about. So I think that they're probably looking for a July-August timeline. And remember, we're looking at the betas that are a couple of months behind the actual internal testing that's going on. So, I don't know. Every week I keep hoping to hear like, all right, 45 days from now, you'll see it. And every week it just doesn't happen, unfortunately. But let's move on. Here is another very interesting piece of information here. There was an interview picked up on MMOReviews.com. This is an interview with Eric Flannum, the lead designer of Guild Wars 2, and he basically goes over a bunch of different things. He talks a lot about PvP and World versus World, but I want to talk about a couple of the quotes that I found in here specifically. One of the coolest things that we've added to World versus World is a persistent mini-dungeon that can be accessed through the three keeps in the center map. That would be the Eternal Battlegrounds. Quote, this area is designed with multiplayer PvP in mind, and players can do things like activate the traps in the mini dungeons to defeat enemy players. Of course, at the end of the arena, there's a chest full of rewards. Unquote.
Yeah, I was really, really excited. Yeah.
That sounds awesome. I can't wait for that.
That adds an interesting dynamic. they had people saying that last, I believe it was last episode we did, and I had to read over it because I just, I don't know, somehow I skipped over it. But so what we're looking at is that if you're leading a big World v. World game, weren't previously attached to World v. World, you're now looking at something that's almost a copy of Aeon. Sorry, but it is. Those that played Aeon, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Where if you control so much of a map or you control a point, you have access to a dungeon. Now, in Aeon, this dungeon gave some incredibly awesome gear. So let's say, Bridger, that you're leading a PvE guild or a guild that just didn't previously care so much about World v. World. Now you have more of a reason to go out in World v. World. It does change the dynamics a little bit. I'm kind of curious if that brings more people out to World v. World, which, depending on what server you are, could be a good or a bad thing. But what kind of loots, you know, what kind of loots, listen to me, what kind of fat loots are gonna drop from this dungeon? I mean, is it going to be worth, you know, spending your time going out there and risking the aura of enemy players out for your blood? I mean, for a PvE-er, they're going to be like, they're going to have to make that decision, you know, because they don't want to deal with other players. But yeah, it may be worth it, you know?
I'm really interested to hear you say it was in Aeon because, you know, myself, I didn't play Aeon. I didn't really play Warhammer that much, but I played DOC. And Dark Age of Camelot, anyone who's played it, as soon as they read that, thought of Darkness Falls, which was a very similar area. It had entrances in everybody's sort of safe zone, but the only way you could get access to it was by holding the majority of the RBR objectives. And so I think some key questions that I had about this mini dungeon are, you know, is it instanced? Is it a separate area? Is the queue for the mini dungeon the same as the one for the Eternal Battlegrounds? I think that's going to be something really important to know.
Well, it says you can access it through the keep. So I wonder if like those underground tunnel things that we found in, for example, I think it's the blue keep. Is that the one in the bottom right there? Like that, you know, that little underground sewer area. Like I imagine like an entrance to a dungeon in there. Now, they call it a mini dungeon, and mini dungeons in the PvE world of Guild Wars 2 are not instanced. So I think it actually takes place in the World v. World itself, which probably Freelancer's not happy about because he's like, where's all my raid going? They're all going to fight in a mini dungeon. We got a keep to take.
So well, it's almost like, I mean, if it's not instanced, it's almost like a whole, like another dimension to the map, right? It's like the underground area, and there just happens to be bosses down there is where I'm imagining it anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like how they mentioned like activating traps and stuff. I just hope they can deliver to how cool that sounds.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Now, I mean, next thing we know, there's going to be giant portals appearing in the middle of PvE that port you to World v. World. I mean,
that's how it was in Darkness Falls, actually. There was like a rock, and there was like, there's a patch note, and then there was this rock that had this portal, and it was like, hey, there's this whole area down here.
Oh, you know what? Game of Trolls, nice name, is asking, would this dungeon be in the next beta? That's a good question, because it's in this interview, but it could very well be in an internal build that's not yet necessarily in the next beta weekend event. I really hope, I mean, you guys saw the blog post today, right? The the one where ArenaNet embraces their inner meme.
Oh, yeah. I have not seen that.
With the servers?
We doubled our servers. It's just like a guru holding up all these servers behind him.
It's like the Matrix thing, right?
Exactly.
The preparation area.
Actually, that does look like the Matrix thing. If they ever have any lag issues, this particular image is going to be reworked to be used against them. So that suggests that they're confident enough to create their own destruction in the form of a meme. Why can't I hold all these servers? Thank you, Zerith. That's a good caption.
No comment.
For those of you that haven't seen it, it's basically on the ArenaNet blog. They've got a picture of a guy in a Guild Wars 2 shirt with a whole bunch of servers behind him. And it says, we doubled our servers. Guild Wars 2 beta is a go. I was disappointed. I saw this blog post and I got all excited. And I clicked on it and I'm like, oh, man, here comes the details. Nope, it's just this image, basically. I was like, okay, they're going to detail all the changes between that last beta and this one and talk about the new interface changes and stuff. Nope, didn't do it. Maybe later this week we'll see something like that. So speaking of, oh no, one more thing before we jump into the PC gamer thing. Here's another quote from that article from the interview with Eric Flannum. Quote, We are still talking about whether or not we want to support any type of world versus world tournaments after we launch. If player interest is high, then I think it's definitely something we'd consider, unquote. Now, what do you guys think they're talking about there exactly? Are they talking about using a tournament format instead of a leaderboard?
I mean, they have to be talking about online, first of all, right? We have to set that straight. Yeah. Like, this is not an offline thing where it's small teams. This is large scale, online, on a website tracking thing, right? I mean, it has to be.
I think so.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think that I'm kind of imagining that it would fit into the, you know, if they do the ELO ranking system, they could just say, okay, the top 10 people, let's do a little tournament. You know, we'll match you up against, you know, just sort of randomly seed it. And I think that would be kind of cool.
I mean,
the only way I could see it, I guess, almost like the way I think about it is if you don't have sort of even teams in terms of numbers, then it's not going to be a tournament at all. It's just going to be one smash and the other one, whoever has more numbers, you know. Like if you have one server who's got 200 people entering this so-called tournament, and you have another server who's got 50, chances are the people with 200 are going to win. I feel like if they wanted to do like a World v. World tournament, they'd almost have to standardize a sort of, you know,
well,
you got to have
yeah,
this
but
many
I mean,
people to go into it.
I think that's a good point, but I don't think they're talking about taking every world and having a tournament. I would assume that they mean like the top 10 participating, like top 10 of the leaderboards. You know, these are active world versus world servers, you know what I mean? Not 50 people.
Yeah.
We brought this up in the Frag World Town Hall community meeting. It was one of the topics that I brought up. The question was, do you think World v. World could be a spectator sport? Meaning that imagine this, everybody listening, imagine if you could control like an aerial camera or even maybe just view a hotspot camera of watching the biggest sieges going on at any given time. Would that be something you'd be interested in? Now, we know from our Dreaming Bay video that just watching that footage, that Bridger you put together, that was immensely popular. You know, everybody loved it, shot up to top of Reddit, et cetera, et cetera. So if that really caught a lot of people's attention and drew even more to Guild Wars 2, could that possibly be something that I'm not really hitting the tournament idea, but maybe just something that if you added a spectate mode would be something really successful? You know, do you think that – let me ask you guys, Vega, specifically you, do you think that World v. World could be something that people would want to watch?
I think it's definitely something people want to watch, but I wouldn't call it a spectator sport because I don't see World v. World as being a esport type scene. It's definitely something that would be awesome to watch as, you know, just watching those videos.
I think it's too niche for it to be a spectator sport. There's going to be like
it'd be a spectator
3%
event.
Or 4% of the community might be really interested in watching that because it's just so slow.
When I say sport, I say it by definition, meaning that you're going to be cheering on one server or another, right? Mm-hmm. You know, based on reputation, you know, Crystal Desert, for example, server we're on, you may be cheering on them, or you may be cheering for the underdog server. You know, all those TL guys are going down, you know, and that's fine. But that's what actually brings in the sport aspect. I didn't say esport. I don't think I did.
What I mean is
a sport aspect of the fact that you're cheering on a certain side over another. You're tuning in to watch your favorite side, be it a server, and you're cheering them on and you're relishing in their victory or mourning for their loss. That's what a sport is. The question is, would you watch and would you follow that scene? Do you think a community could be made out of it? Do you think websites could pop up covering it?
I just think in addition to what you said about what a sport is, that I also view a sport as something that has a sort of level playing field, you know? It's at the very basic, you're cheering on either sides, but whenever you're cheering on either sides, it's always on a level playing field. And World v. World isn't always a level playing field.
I think we're looking at this.
I mean, either way, I think it's still something that'd be awesome to watch, but I don't think it's going to be like a sort of blowing up kind of thing.
I think we're looking at this in the wrong way. I think when they say world versus world tournaments, I kind of see it as server versus server, where, for example, at the end of the year, they take the servers that have accumulated the most points over the course of the year, like the top, I don't know, 16 servers or 8 servers or however many they decide to do, and say, okay, we're now going to have, you know, a 1 week rotation and with actual elimination where these servers are outside the normal pool of matchups, and instead they're kind of set up in a round robin style for a couple weeks at a time. Maybe they have to do a Swiss style in order to make sure that everybody's playing everybody, and then they can figure out, okay, over the last couple of weeks between, I don't know, let's say mid-November towards before Christmas, you know, those kind of areas there, to say, okay, we're going to do a find out which is the best server for this year, you know,
right.
and have it be not an elimination, but probably a Swiss-style thing where we find out, okay, this server had the most points overall after all the matches are concluded. I don't know. I think that could be interesting.
Yeah, I mean, we already know they're going to do, like, rankings, right? Like, a ranked list.
Right, we're talking about leaderboards. And I think that's what they're talking about here, is replacing the leaderboards with a tournament-style system at some point for a special occasion.
Well, I think it makes sense to have, you know, maybe, like, seasons. So you have your leaderboard, but then at the end of each season, the top X of that leaderboard get to play in a little bracket or whatever. I mean, it doesn't have to be, like, an official thing, but, you know, it'd be kind of cool just to say, you know, our server won that season, you know what I mean? We were, not just to say we were top for X number of weeks, you know what I mean?
Well, they're talking about doing something similar for the PvP too, weren't they? That it's going to be broken out into seasons, or am I making that up?
The problem, PvP? Yeah. Go ahead.
The problem with PvP though is I'm still stuck on, I hate the way they judge a player skill in that game. I think it's going to ruin you know, tournaments. If they did a similar thing in structure PvP where they just took the top random players from throughout Guild Wars 2, they're basing it right now based on how many games you played, and that's it. And that's a problem.
I heard that's being reworked, actually.
Somewhere if it is, somebody somewhere heard my cry for help, because that system
You know
was
what it was? I think it was in the leaked patch notes. If you read it correctly, it kind of seemed like they were reworking the glory thing and using glory only for those rewards, like the skin rewards, and that they were implementing some other system to track ranking. That's kind of what I read into those. I don't know. Somebody in the chat room helped me out. Does anybody else remember reading that? Because I almost certainly remember something about that. I don't think we mentioned it when we were looking at it, because it was very vague. It wasn't really solid, so I don't think that's why we didn't mention it. It just seemed to me that that's how I would read it. That's something I guess we'll have to find out. But yeah, I agree with you entirely. The whole, okay, you get XP no matter how badly you do, you know, that kind of ranking
system.
Yeah, but
I mean, That issue was kind of a talking point in StarCraft 2, because for the Blizzard Invitationals, they used the ladder, and so there were a lot of pros who actually complained that they weren't playing on the ladder, they were playing in international tournaments, and so they didn't have ladder points, and you know, they were pretty miffed that they didn't get invited. I don't know if they changed that eventually, but it was an interesting talking point, and I completely agree with Freelancer on this, that it should be based on your skill, not on your time spent in the game, and I think that that's kind of a theme in Guild Wars 2.
Well, a lot of people in chat are saying that that there is something different from glory now. Back when we talked about this last few weeks ago, there wasn't. So if there is something different now, then that's great. They're definitely evolving the game.
Well, I think, weren't they always talking about the tournaments that it was going to be something you have to voluntarily enter, and that...
Right, versus five tournaments and earning qualifier points for the monthly tournaments and things like that, I don't have a problem with that system. Does anybody else have a problem with that system? I think that system works well, because it's a team-based game, so you should enter as a team.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about when I was bringing up the tournaments in the PvP, not the whole
glory
how you
thing.
Get points in a specific game.
Right. All right, anyway, I think we may have gone a little far afield. Bring us back, Oku. Bring us back around.
Sure. Well, I think one final point I really want to make on this that kind of brings it back to what Free was talking about, that there is definitely an audience for watching organized large-scale combat, and the proof of that is in the EVE Online battle reports. And so what you don't see is you don't see like a constant live view. Now, I mean, people stream EVE, obviously, but what you do see a lot of traffic on is every, you know, 2 weeks or whatever, there's a constant war between two major super alliances, and there'll be a guy who basically just writes about it and writes about the battle of whatever. And, you know, here was the outcome at that station or whatever. And I think that we'll probably see the same thing for every 2 week battle in World vs. World. At least I hope we do.
Yeah.
You just gave me a great idea. A TL battle report.
Officer, for a new officer position.
The scribe.
The scribe. The seneschal. The seneschal sounds more. Okay, Bard. Does he get
brave,
to sing?
Brave Sir Freelancer.
If you call him the Bard, you have to let him sing.
We could get the Bajoran guy that just did that awesome track for you.
There you go. All right. Let's move on to the next piece here. PC Gamer plays the new build. That was this past weekend. If you watched the live stream or if you want to check it out yourself, it is available on Twitch TV. There's a link there in the show notes. TalesofTyria.com is where you can find it. This is his desktop. What is this nonsense? Everybody in the chat room was apparently yelling at him about it. But anyway.
All right, for those not looking at the stream, let me explain this to you.
Let's go back.
Take one icon and multiply it by how many is there? Like, there's 12 there, and then there's
2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 11 by.
And they're all, the interesting thing is they're all images. So I'm wondering if he created all these, you know, or if it's just something that he has to do a lot of publishing.
11 by 25 in terms of desktop icons in a grid on his desktop. But yeah, there's a lot. There's MP3s, there's folders, there's images everywhere. Like, he uses his desktop to dump everything. It's horrible. Anyway, that's not what we're talking about, though. The guy apparently was like, yeah, lay off my desktop, man. I know about it. I know. The chat room's now going, I'm blind.
I want to ask him if he legally downloaded those MP3s.
So anyway, a couple of things to quickly note. And if you watch the whole thing, he talks about a lot of different of the stuff here. But something to note is you can see the dodge bar as he gets up and leaves. The dodge bar is now located directly above the health. It's no longer located to the side. It's just a small curved yellow sphere. I kind of like that. That looks nice.
Can I be the first to use the term dodge hat?
The dodge hat. Oh, I love it. Oku breaks the world's immersion. It's a dodge hat. And there he goes.
There you go. New meme. This stream killed me. I watched it with all the other Team Legacy members when it was first announced, and I couldn't watch more than 10 minutes of it. It was just such bad frame rates. You would think guys at press computers doing these reviews would have better systems than that. It was pretty bad. Now, what we saw of it, though, was a lot of interesting UI changes, which was nice to see.
You can see that they added...
I like the split in the dodge bar.
The split in the dodge bar is kind of nice. It really gives you that 50% mark.
What I loved is the condition timer thing. I think you're about to highlight that.
Oh, timer. No, I didn't notice any timer. I was going to say they moved the conditions over to where the dodge bar used to be.
Well, the icon, if you watch it, actually kind of like rotates as it goes away.
I think I see what you're talking about. Yeah, the white line is like a clock wipe where it's slowly disappearing. So that helps you give a much better understanding of how long that buff or debuff has. Very cool little thing. Good spot. I missed that when I was looking at it. Very cool. So there's a bunch of other cool little things in here. You can watch the whole thing yourself if you want to check it out. I did want to mention a couple of the other things I noticed. Somebody said there's a sell junk button that is in this build. No guarantee that this build is the one that we'll be playing this weekend. I think he mentioned he was in a new zone that wasn't in the previous beta, and he said that this zone is guaranteed to be in beta weekend number 2. We just have the PC Gamer guy's word on that, unless somebody else knows something that I didn't know.
Let's cross our fingers and hope.
Yeah. Even when the traits... Okay. This is a cool new change. This is something that everybody was asking for. Let's say you're playing the game and you haven't played it before, and you get a new trait point, and my hand just disappeared. Wow, that's cool. Oh, God! Okay. Green screen fun aside. The traits, even though they're locked, you can click on them, and then it shows you all the traits that are available in the major trait slot, so you don't have to, like, go and look it up on a wiki or spend all your trait points in order to see what's in that major trait slot. So really, really excellent and I think very important interface change there that made it much easier. The dodge bar, we talked about that. There's a critical health hit blood splatter. That's what people think it is anyway. Let me open this up here. They noticed that somebody figured this out. They froze the frame at the right moment that there's this like blood splatter effect on the hit number.
Oh,
and they think that's when you get a crit. Because not all the numbers have this, so they think this is just crit, so it's just kind of nice.
Well, it used to say critical, right? Now maybe
I think
it
used to be a bigger number. Now with this,
I think it was like bold. It was like a bold.
It's like bold. Number. Yeah, I like this a lot better. Much clearer that you just got a critical hit. I like that. So I don't know. Chat room, did anybody else in there know anything specific?
They added the key modifiers.
Oh yeah, they added key modifiers. I forgot about that one.
Yes.
That's like the first thing the guy confirms if you're listening to it. He's like, yay, they added shift modifiers or something like that. So that's awesome. I think that's it for really like small changes. There's probably a couple other small UI changes in there that I missed that we'll be able to enjoy this weekend, hopefully. However, there are a couple of really, really big changes. So let me see if I can pull up some images for you guys specifically showing these changes. So, Vega, did you see how they changed the utility skills? Let's start with just the utility skill unlocking system.
I didn't watch the video, so if you could break it down for me, that'd be fantastic. All right.
Okay, did you watch it? Did you get this utility thing?
I mean, I'm vaguely familiar with it, but I mean, I could explain it to you, but first you need to get to level 10 points and, you know, receiving explanations, and then I can give you the full thing.
You haven't. All right. The next time you're on Tales of Tyria, though, you'll probably get get enough experience to get that. Okay, let's break it down here. So basically, this is what the new utility skills area looks like, the slot skills. And you can see on the left, those are the three slots that he has activated. Now, this little triangle thing that you see on the screen, and for those of you not listening, basically what happens is the skills in the utility section have been broken up into three tiers. You can only buy skills in the first tier until you've bought a total of 5 skills in that tier. Then you can buy things in tier 1 or tier 2 until you have purchased up to 5 things in the second tier, and then you can purchase anything in tier 3. So basically, you have to unlock 10 skills before you have access to everything. And that's only if you unlock 5 in the first tier and then immediately unlock 5 in the second tier, then you'll have access to everything that you can get. So that means that you have to spend at least, I think, it looks like everything in the first tier is like 1 point. So let's say 5 points in the first tier and then 3 points, it looks like, in like the second tier. So 3 each in the second tier would be 15. So you have to spend 20 points, 20 skill points, before you'll have access to whatever's in that third tier. Now, theoretically, this is only an issue when you're leveling, so I don't see too many people outraged about this, per se.
So, for that leak, when we talked about this like a few weeks ago, so once you get to 30, can you put skills wherever you want, or is it, am I understanding it right, that for those first 5...
This is different than what we talked about before, because what we talked about before and what we'll talk about in a second is the whole trait gating thing. This is for utility skills unlocking.
Okay.
If you're in structured PvP, this doesn't matter at all because you are at level 80 and you can pick any utility skill you want, right? But this only matters for while you are leveling up a character, you will not have access to certain utility skills until you've spent 20 skill points in a specific pattern.
I see.
Yeah, I think you hit on the logic behind this perfectly. You said when you're at the max level, this doesn't matter to you. I think what this is it's a way to introduce players to certain. You're not following Guild Wars 2, and you just load up, and it's like, hey, you can spend your points on any of these, you know, 12. I think it's like 12 utilities or more than that, I guess. But you know, it might be confusing to a new player. Okay, well, this looks good, but what if I want to wait a little bit to get this extra point to get that? It kind of makes them maybe not so apt to try something out. And so I think that maybe that's one reason they're doing it.
Is it prevent people from being overwhelmed? Is that the idea?
Possibly.
But on the flip side, when I saw that, I'm at 3 points, but there's this really cool skill that's 4 points. Let me go explore this area and go get that extra skill point.
That's
in that other
you are exploring, yeah.
But, I mean...
Well, this does.
We'll see how it fares, but I never liked the whole restrictions that they've been.
They've made every skill in the first tier 1 point, at least as far as I can tell. What this does is guarantee that by the time you are level 13, right? Because that's when you start getting. Is it 10 or 11? I can't remember.
11, I believe.
11. Okay, so by the time you're level 13, you will have the ability to buy 3 utility skills. You can't utilize all your utility skills until you get to level 20, but at the very least, you'll have the option of 3 at any given moment to slot into the 2 places that you can put them in. Actually, is it 2 places? Is it 5, 10, and 20, right, is when those utilities unlock? So yeah, I mean, maybe they're just trying to make sure that everybody has a variety of things and they don't stick to the couple that they buy right at the beginning.
I think also to counter argue Oku. if you did save your points to buy that one thing that sounded cool, and then you spend 7 points or whatever to get that one skill, and then you find out, wow, this really isn't that useful to me. Now,
or it's only useful in certain situations. Yeah. So this is designed to protect new players. Is that? I think that's like the general consensus about this system.
Yeah. I think it's just to give it. It's to give the whole leveling thing more structure. It seems like.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, I don't think anybody's really outraged about this, since it doesn't affect anything once you get past what, level 20 or 30. You're done. You don't have to worry about it.
I think what you guys aren't considering is the impact on World v. World. Imagine this. What if some of those initial unlock skills for a certain class are far more powerful in World v. World than other initial unlock skills for another class? Have we considered that? No. So
but it's only going to matter for the first week, and then it's not going to matter anymore. Really?
But it doesn't take, but if it mattered for the first day, people will care.
I think it's a fair point, because what if it turns out that there's one, tier one skill that's really powerful on a certain class, but that's not what you play, and your guild leader's like, hey, we really need that skill, go roll another character, you know, get to level 5 and join us out here because we just need you to have that utility.
Because your ranger class is going to take too long to get the good things that help the guild.
Right.
You have to go roll a necromancer and level the ranger on your own time. We need the necromancer because he has this thing, and your ranger's not good enough. That could be.
But the skills from 1 to 10, are they really going to be that powerful? You think? Like, I feel like. Now that they're sort of putting like structure to this, it seems like they've broken down the skills into what's more powerful.
The screenshot Bridger just brought up, that was Epidemic right there, first skill. Do I have that right, Bridger? If you pull it up again, I believe it was. Okay. Epidemic by itself is one of the most obscenely overpowered utility skills out there, and it is tier one. Now,
at
I'm
least
not going to explain
as of the
why.
Last beta.
as of the last beta, yeah. Now, all the Team Legacy members know, what the deal is with that. We've had numerous meetings about it. But that skill right there being tier one tells me that I would rather all of the guild roll Necromancer for the first day.
I
would, right there, because I know that if they haven't changed the skill, that we're going to steamroll everybody we come across. So that makes me wonder. I mean, ArenaNet's going to balance it. I understand that. But that also makes me wonder, is there not other traits for other classes? I mean, what if the Elementalist starts with its mass res? All right, picture that in World v. World. Would that not cause a guild leader to possibly sway to try to encourage half of his guild in World v. World to roll Elementus because of that signet of rebirth or whatever?
Yeah,
I forget the name.
Signet
of renewal.
Yeah.
And so right there, Bridger, if you had to do the demographics and consider the fact that we're going to be sieging and stuff and you'll be losing a lot of people, would you not think it better to have more Elementalists for that aspect if they were the only one with that signet available in the first 10 levels?
Yeah.
And you're saying in the first week and stuff, but even with structured PvP and stuff that Team Legacy is doing, I know that we're definitely not the only guild that's concerned about that first week. I mean, first impressions are everything for every guild out there. And knowing that in
PvP,
the first...
this doesn't affect structured PvP at all.
No, not at all. That's what I'm saying,
unlocked.
Aside from structured PvP.
Okay.
In World v. World, as well as structured PvP, first impressions are everything. You want to get out there and you want to have basically hit the gate running. And if hitting the gate running means that I will have a strong upper hand with certain classes now, then that's an issue for me. So it doesn't bother me yet because I haven't seen all the skills. You know, we know what Epidemic does, but there, without seeing all the other tier one skills, basically the skills I know as a guild leader that all of my classes will have, are they good, are they bad? I don't want to be the guy that labels a guardian as useless in the first week. I mean, how wrong is that? You know, I don't want to be the guy that labels my warriors OP in the first week. Now, it's not going to matter. You're right. 2-3 weeks down the road, not going to matter at all. But in the first week in some guilds, the first maybe possibly 2 weeks, it is going to matter. It's going to be a big deal.
Yeah.
And let's even put it more in perspective. I mean, getting to tier 3 might take 2 days, maybe 3. Getting to tier 2 shouldn't take that long at all, because you only need 5 skill points to unlock before you have access to all the tier 2 stuff. So again, like you said, it highly depends on what they put at tier 3. It's possible that what they put at tier 3 is not the most powerful stuff, but the stuff that's very situational or conditional that they don't want people to unlock until they know how to use the general stuff. So the idea here is to make sure that when you unlock something, it's useful for you until you get really used to the class and understand everything. Then you can get the more situational things and slot those in for the situations where you need them. But then the question is raised, Does that mean that stuff that's really situational to world versus world is going to get stuck locked away at tier 3? And then we come back to the problem you're talking about, freelancers. So, yeah, this is something we're going to have to check out in the beta and see if, for example, I mean, Team Legacy, we, like you said, we looked at all these things and we tried to determine, okay, what makes a class really useful in world versus world? It, okay, for the Guardian, it's this and this, and for the Necromancer, it's this and this. This is what makes them shine. If that's locked away, we can say no guardians until you're level 30. That you don't want to have to have incentive to say that.
And it probably wouldn't happen like that. But it still is sort of, you know, if you are the Guardian and let's say the skills that – let's say you're in a big World v. World guild and the skills that you're just stuck with at level 1 to 10 are skills that aren't really optimal for World v. World, then you're somehow lesser than other classes. And I think that this system just sort of, in that respect, you know, doesn't really play out very well.
Yeah. So let's move off of that, the less controversial of these two major issues.
Yeah.
And let's talk about the trait changes. And let's see if I can find a good screenshot of this. But in general, the major issue here, and is this the one that I'm looking for? Yeah, this is kind of the thing that I'm looking for. Let me open up these two individually if I can. The idea here is that, like we talked about a couple of weeks ago, only slightly differently, I can't talk and copy and paste at the same time. That's a really bad thing to have. All right, there we go. So let me zoom over here. At Tier 1 on the traits, you can have access to... It's the same image, isn't it? Oh, I screwed it up. first image. There we go. Let's blow this one up. Bingo. That's the one I wanted. So here, what you can see...
I'm seeing it.
Here, what button?
There we go. I see it on the stream.
There we go. I think it's on there now, yes? All right. Yes. So what you can see here is that when you get to the first tier of traits, 10 points into a trait line, you have access to 6 of the traits available in that line. When you get to the second tier, master tier, I guess you could call it, well, adept and then master and then grandmaster, you have access to 10, so an additional 4. And then when you get to grandmaster, you have access to all 12 for that grandmaster slot. So what this is doing is it's a slightly less restrictive version of the one that we talked about during the patch notes when we thought it was 4, 4, and 4, and this one it's 6, 4, and 2. Now, The internet is exploding because this is confirmation of the patch notes thing. When it was just the patch notes thing, they were like, well, maybe it's not real. But here we see it is real. So, Oku, we didn't get your thoughts on this on the last time we were talking about it. What are your thoughts about this whole gated trait system where two traits will be locked away, two major traits will be locked away until you put 30 points into a tree?
I really hate that you put me on the spot with this because I really like to be positive about stuff and I can't really think of anything good about this. I mean, it's honestly, I think a lot of people might be feeling the same thing. Like, one of the coolest things about Guild Wars 2 and one of the things that, like, I'm, like, spamming to everyone around me, like, hey, that game's crap. Look at Guild Wars 2. Everything is unlocked. Everything is available. You don't have to go to the end of the line to get the best trait. You don't have to, you know, play it like WoW. You get everything for you because your player skill is more important. I think that this is a, sort of a knock against that. Now, and I will say, you know, I want to be optimistic. I want to say that there is a reason they did this. And, you know, some people have said maybe it's too hard to balance. Maybe it's, they felt like people were ignoring some traits and they don't want them to ignore them. Now, I don't think that making you use them is the best way to not ignore them. But, you know, there must be a good reason. But, yeah, in general, I think that it's not what I was excited about, I guess, if I can say it that way.
Well, let me pose this question. To me, what this change could be a response to is imagine if, for a moment, the most powerful build is the one where you put maybe 20-20, 10-10-10, where you take the best two traits from two lines and the best traits from the other three lines, right? So this would be the most spread out build you could possibly get on the trait menu, and it's more powerful than anything else, specifically because you get the best trait from every single line, the ones that synergize really well together or the most powerful or what have you. Whereas if you were to go up a single line and get three traits there and three traits in another line and do the super specialist trait line, you'd wind up having to take maybe two slightly weaker traits in this line, even though another line has a more powerful version. Like, if you imagine a power scale, some of these 12 traits are going to be good, some of them are going to be bad. So if you take the best from every line, then that's the best possible build. Imagine if that was the situation. This would be a great way to solve that specific problem. So I wonder that if that's the problem.
Yeah. I mean, that was the situation, right? But, I mean, the solution isn't to say, hey, you had all these crappy traits that you ignored. You have to use those. Don't ignore them. The solution is to make them all overpowered. Like, make them all good.
I wouldn't be as angry at this change if when I got to the end, to the Grandmaster level, that I can use, like, then the other two, I could use whatever I want in those. You know what I'm saying? In slot one, you're limited to those five. In slot two, you're limited to those 12. Six and ten, whatever. And then in Grandmaster, you get all of them. I would want it to be when you get to Grandmaster that all the other ones, now you could pick from whatever you want.
So you're saying in your point of view, if you put 30 points in the line, every single major trait should have every single possible trait available to you at that point.
Yeah. Only when you get to the very end. I feel like that would be like a decent compromise to appease the people that are like, this sucks, you're ruining the game, and the people that are like, I guess this is good.
I think this is a sort of more of a balance thing. I think it's guised as something to be more complicated, but I mean, there were a lot of, and I just have experience mainly with the Mesmer, but there were some traits in each tree that just seemed like they were the have to get traits. Did you guys experience that with your class? Like, certain trees, well, like there was just some traits you couldn't go without. It just
correct.
I think it was more evident of there were certain traits that you just didn't need.
Yeah, so I look at this more as something that they have kind of subliminally added tiers to the traits. You know, we're talking just removing two at a time, but I think this is more so like they acknowledge the fact that certain traits are chosen no matter what. So we're going to put those as tier three because they are probably the most powerful ones and sort of have you pick between them. Because if you pick within the same tree, let's say with the power tree, all of the same, you know, most powerful traits, it might be a little overpowered. So they're forcing you to pick, let's say, the baby trait and then the medium trait and then, you know, the big trait. That's the way I see it anyways. I don't see it as anything beyond that. I just see it as a balancing issue.
I mean, it certainly balances the game out, but it's such a big change to have all that freedom and then all of a sudden you just literally took away two-thirds of the potential.
Lot of people say that. A lot of people say, oh, but there was so much freedom, so many possible builds. I think it was the illusion of freedom, because still the most optimal build, like what Freelancer is saying, is you get the best possible traits from every tree. Is if that's the only really optimal way of doing anything, then it's the illusion of freedom, because yes, it is more free, but everybody's going to wind up with the same cookie cutter build of, okay, I'm going to take 20 points in this, 20 points in this, and 10, 10, 10 in order to get the best trait from each of those, the must-have traits. It seems to me like this is going to promote more diversity, because you're not able to simply take most powerful, most powerful, most powerful, done. You have to take other things that go along with it. And Freelancer's having a real problem with
Overseer Cat.
Overseer Cat. He's trying to butt into this situation.
I cannot. Overseer Cat clearly does not approve to this change.
I could not disagree with what you just said, Bridger, more. So
okay.
If you had cookie cutter builds when you had all that freedom, now you're really going to have cookie cutter builds. Because you're bringing that freedom away.
Well, no, because what this has done is broken up the cookie cutter builds, so you can't make those anymore. And if you can't make the most optimal build, maybe there are more suboptimal builds.
No, but you're still going to. Yeah, there was cookie cutters. You're going to have cookie. There's going to be more cookie cutters now, so than there was before, because now you don't have the option of, well, every tree, every line had, you know, a few skills that are really powerful, so you can mess around with those. Now you have to get to the end. So now you're limiting the amount of I forgot what I was going to say.
Cuz the cat.
I just disagree.
You're petting the cat from...
There's going to be more cookie cutters.
Sorry.
I just see, like... I think it's entirely possible that if there was one or two builds for the warrior, for example, that there were, like, must-have things that you just... These traits are too strong not to have in this configuration. Then if you bust that, basically, if you, you know, take out that one build and say, no, you can't have that one, maybe there are a lot of others that are just slightly weaker than it, and now they are all balanced with each other because you're forcing people to split up more. And a lot of people have the same reaction to that you have, Vega, and I had the same kind of same reaction. I'm reserving my judgment until we actually see what traits are where and whether the system really feels restrictive. And I had the same initial reaction. I thought to myself, you know, and I see this a lot in the forums where they go, "You're taking away our freedom!" And that's seen as an overwhelmingly negative thing. Automatically, anything that removes choice is always bad. But that's not necessarily true in all cases. It has to be a balance, because the idea of game design is creating a restrictive environment and giving the player a specific set of tools and saying, here's what you have. Try and beat this puzzle. Try and beat this AI. Try and beat this specific, you know, multiplayer experience. These are the tools. Do it, right? And if you are simply given all kinds of freedom and you're given all this stuff, it would be too easy. So they restrict you. They pull you away. They take away stuff. They make it so that you can't do anything unless you're in this stance, unless you have this gun, unless you have this jetpack, which prevents you from getting this other thing, right? I mean, that's the kind of thing that's in all classes. If you run fast, you can't hit hard. If you move slowly, you get to hit hard and you get to take a lot of damage. Those trade-offs are what everything's about, right?
Right. Well, we're not talking about getting every trait, though, right? I mean, we're just talking about, you still had to specialize a little bit. And I think one thing I want to say is, like, I'm not necessarily disappointed in ArenaNet or the game in general, but I think that what it is that it's like, we knew that this system worked because that's how it was in WoW. You had to specialize in a certain, you know, you had to go way down the line to get the best thing. But the hope was that you could have a more free system and that it would work out. And what this seems to indicate is that it just wasn't going to work out. It was too hard to balance.
Yeah, I'm happy because this is starting to get to the point where they're balancing things out, and they still want you to be able to choose or be anything. You know, we're not going to hit that conversation again, but they still want you to play the tanky class or the supporting class if you want to. They're just doing it in a way that forces you to sort of balance your character out more, so you can't go too much into any particular area. It's just balancing. It's a way of implementing balance.
But I think they could have left the tree the way it was and spent more time trying to balance the skills out so that they weren't as powerful. I feel like this is the quick and dirty way of saying, well, we have so many damn skills and it's going to be really hard to balance those out. Let's just instead restrict what players can actually get to.
Yes and no. I mean, if you left all the skills and you just tried to balance skills nonstop and you still gave them complete access to everything, then what you're running into then is they have to dumb down every skill so that they just don't have that wow factor anymore. See, right now, you guys know that in your class, if you choose a particular trait, that you're... My cat clearly does not agree with you, Vega, so it's 2v1 here. if you choose a particular trait, you're essentially, you know, it does something more than just an average trait. You know, it's hard to explain, but the traits you choose in Guild Wars 2 have a big impact on your character. If you just allowed everybody to have all traits at all times and then you just balanced all the traits out, not only are you creating a nightmare for the balancing team, where if they balance the cooldown of this skill by 0.5 seconds, they got to balance this skill by 0.8. You're also it just seems to make sense to me. That's all. That just like previous MMOs, even new games coming out now, Path of Exile, I mean, there has to be some sort of tree set up that defines a more powerful trait from another. And no matter what you do, Vega, you're not going to be able to balance out all the traits to say, okay, all Mesmer traits are now equal. That's impossible.
I'm not saying to do that. I'm just saying, you know, there were certain builds that were clearly very strong, like the Warrior Glass Cannon build, and there were other, you know, even there were some Engineer builds that were very strong because of, like, one or two traits that you got. I'm not saying balance every single trait. Some of them were perfectly fine. I'm saying you find the ones that are very overpowered and you bring them down a little bit. That's what you do to balance the game.
Let me interject here.
I'm just saying, I mean, my bottom line is, no matter what they've changed, the number of builds you're going to have now are less than what you had before.
That is
whether
true.
I'm not saying it's good or bad. I'm just saying there are less builds. That's a fact.
Let me ask you this, Vega. And I think that what this really boils down to is everyone wants is they want the spread builds to be effective, and they want the highly specialized 30-30-10 builds to be effective, right? Because what VOA1 said in the chat earlier is he thinks that what this is going to do is force you into taking a 30-30-10. That's what he imagines that the new trait tiering system is going to do is, oh, if all the good stuff is at 30 points, then you're going to have to put two traits lines all the way up to 30. And my only argument, my hope, is that that's not the case. Because I think ArenaNet, as part of many of the things that they've said and done, has shown that they want hybrid builds to be effective. Because not only with the gearing system where, you know, you get more than one stat on a thing and you get more of them. You know, they're trying to make the jack-of-all-trade hybrid builds more effective because they're ineffective in every other MMO and every other thing.
But if you think about it, that's how utilities work, right? I mean, you get the slot and you get to put whatever you want in there. And major traits used to be the same sort of cool thing with that freedom, but now they're not.
But
I disagree again. In this new build, you can't have as many hybrid.
Okay, but hang on a second. But let me reestablish what I meant to ask here before. So Vega, would you agree that what we're trying to do is make the specialized and the hybrid builds more or less balanced? You want there to be optimal versions of both, right? Is that the idea?
Ask that again.
Okay. Highly specialized 30-30-10 builds. We want those to be effective, and we want there to be builds in the 30-30-10 style, but we also want there to be more split builds, like 20-20-10-10-10 or 20-20-20-10, right? We want there to be optimal versions of each. We want them all to work, right? That's the idea, the ideal.
Well, yeah, that's what they want, and
is that what you want? Is that what you would like to see? That's what I'm asking.
What I want to see is I don't want to see more cookie cutter builds. And I feel that with this new system.
Well, hang on. Define cookie cutter build.
Cookie cutter builds are if you're going to go an engineer and you want to use turrets, you got to do 30-30-10. If you're going engineer and you want to use your elixir gun, you got to go 30-30-20 or whatever the hell.
In these specific lines. Okay, I see what you're
saying. In these specific lines, you have to get those things. Otherwise, you can't. There's no experimenting. What I don't like is taking away the fun of, well, let me try this build, or let me try this skill set. You know, when you in the previous version, that you had that ability to do that a lot more because you can get 10 points in and get one of the best traits, or you could put 20 points in and then you get two of the best traits. You know, and there was a lot more to play with. Now it's, well, you're going to put 10 into there, but what are you going to get out of it? You're not going to get anything good, so don't even bother with it.
I think that's a misconception, though. I think you're assuming that all six traits that they're putting at tier one are going to be crap. But I don't think that's going to be the case.
I don't think they're going to be crap, but they're definitely not going to be as good as the
I think they will be.
Tier
I'm going to have to agree with Bridger here. Because in Thief specifically, some of the builds that I'm looking at, a lot of the skills are at the 15 and below mark. I mean, I'm talking about minor traits. Those are like the most, like especially in acrobatics, if you're familiar with Thief. In acrobatics in 15, you get basically a return on endurance with dodge, and it was like the most powerful trait at 15.
We're kind of theory crafting a lot of this stuff here, but let me bring in a little bit of math here. This is from an email from Bash. Basheric that sent us some math here for us, and I'm going to rely on him here. What he did is he took a look at if you do a 30-30-10 build, with the old system, you had 36 possible options. With the new system, you have 30 options, right? If you do a 30-20-20, it goes 36 in the old system, 32 in the new system. So in those very specialized situations, nothing much really changes. You don't have a lot of restriction in those specialized areas. You only lose like maybe four or six possible situations. Now, if we go to the 20-20-20-10 build, under the old system, we had 48 possible builds, setups. And now we only have 36. So that's a much bigger difference. It's a difference of 12. Under the 20-20-10-10-10, which is the most spread that you can possibly get, on the old system, you had 60 possible combinations of traits, and now you have 38. So what this change has done is bring into line, essentially, the hybrid spread builds with the specialized builds. The specialized builds were in the 30s. The hybrid builds were upwards of 48 to 60 possible combinations, which means that those were almost always going to have the overpowered or really, really good combinations in them because you had way more possibilities. Right now, they've brought them all down into the 30, 32, 34, 36, 36, 38. Now, the spread system still has 38, and the most specialized system only has 30, so the spread system still gives you more options, but it's not 60. And I think that's the biggest change here, is that the spread builds now don't have the potential to have super overpowered combinations if ArenaNet's done it right. And I hope that that's the only effect, really, is that spread builds are still possible, and I hope that, like Vega, we don't see cookie-cutter builds where, oh, well, you're using a rifle and turrets. You have to use this. It's the only viable thing. I'd like to see two or three different things that are viable if you use turrets and a rifle, and another two or three things that are viable if you use grenades and elixir gun or whatever you want to put in there.
Yeah.
I gotta say that in terms of what was his name, Bridger, that sent that email?
Bash.
Yeah, he hits me in the heart because that's pretty much how I feel in terms of the balance. We mentioned, in terms of less is more.
Oh, he's in the chat right now.
He is. Awesome.
The number of traits available. That's not the number of combinations. Did I read that wrong?
It's less number of combinations. Traits, or we'll just say focusing trait lines, like they are now, where you are slightly more limited to the way you can choose your traits, opens up essentially what I'm worried about, or it helps quell my worries for tournaments. We're kicking off this big tournament, and one of my biggest concerns is those, Vega saying cookie cutter builds. That's fine. That's one thing. That is a valid concern. But another concern is that crazy build that is so obscenely OP that it just breaks the entire tournament. So when I'm hosting this tournament and I'm getting all these great guilds coming from everywhere with their five-man teams, I can be more sure that with a slightly more controlled system that they are developing now, that I don't have to worry so much about those broken builds because all of the most powerful traits are somewhat locked away, where you can only choose one or two of them.
I just realized. Two pair says that 14, 14, 14, 14, 14 is the most spread. And he's right. We should have a special tournament where the only trade options you get is 14 straight across.
<That'd>
that would
awesome.
Be a crazy fun tournament, like way in the future. I just had that idea. I got to throw it out there. Sorry, go ahead.
But think about it, though. By controlling ever so slightly the kind of traits that people can choose, you are essentially creating balance by itself, without even balancing the traits themselves. So they, as far as esports is concerned, which is what I'm really focused about, is it's a far more controlled environment now, whereas previously you're running basically a Path of Exile type setup where you can build these crazy, I forget the name of the ability, the phase strike builds that are completely obscenely OP, and that there's nothing nobody can do about it, because had it been created by anybody else, it would have been fine. But somebody specializing in it with no limitations whatsoever, which is what the previous Guild Wars 2 was like, now you can't do that anymore. I just don't see anything wrong with this.
I think there's going to be overpowered builds no matter what.
That's what I was going to say. No matter
what they do, someone else.
But you have far more control by limiting, the better traits.
So now you're going to have, like, the thing is, it's all relative. So yeah, the warrior glass cannon build, he won't be as powerful, but he could still be pretty powerful. But everyone else is restricted the same amount that he is. So if someone was also going an overpowered build, but his overpowered power build beat him, I'm just saying, just because they've done this doesn't mean that there's not going to be overpowered builds no matter what. There's always going to be someone out there that finds something broken and then they got to patch it.
I mean, the comment I was going to make was, I agree with you, Freelancer, and I think that that's a very, good point. But that having overpowered builds or secret builds, if you will, is not necessarily that bad of a thing. I mean, a lot of StarCraft II tournaments were won with sort of secret builds. I know that in Guild Wars 1, that was a popular thing. Of course, Guild Wars 1 is famous for being impossible to balance.
Right. I think Guild Wars 1 is one extreme, right? And, and like, you know, super restrictive, you know, specific, I don't know, maybe Rift was an example. I never played it, but let's just say, for example, so super restrictive MMO, which makes all the classes forced to basically do the same. Obviously, somewhere in the middle, you know, it's a false dichotomy to say you can have only one or the other. Somewhere in the middle, there's a compromise. And I mean, even World of Warcraft, even though you have those 31 point talents that are like the must-haves, and everybody always goes, you know, 31-9 or 31-11, whatever the thing was, there's still the situation where that is less restrictive than something else that it could have been. So I think this is still less restrictive than like the talent trees in World of Warcraft. So I think we're still on the correct version, the correct side.
I know,
it's still
better, but I like the compromise that I suggested of once you get to 30, you're opened up to all the traits, skills that you want to get.
The problem that you're talking about right there, though, is what they've done by putting 2 points at the 30 point. Those two traits will never interact with this current system. So if you take two traits that, when together, are broken, when not taken together, are perfectly valid. And if you need to nerf them so that when they're taken together, they are normal, when you put them apart, they'll never get taken separately. They'll only ever be taken together. However, with this system, they can make sure that those traits will never, ever be taken together, because there's 2 points at level 30. You can only have one of them at level 30. So I think this is their solution to, well, each of these trait lines seems to have two things that synergize way too well together. We'll lock the two that synergize the best up at level 30 so they'll never have to meet again. And then we don't have to worry about balancing those two traits with each other. And
let's see how this next beta weekend happens, and we'll hit this topic again because it's a lot of theory crafting going on right now.
Agreed. We'll all return to this with our – and like I said, I – might just be just as outraged as Vega when I actually look at the system. If it turns out it's not done well, then I might be just as outraged as Vega. That was my initial reaction. I tried to cool
myself. Speaking of which, who is excited for the beta weekend?
Yes!
I'm mad. I'm going to be out of town.
Combo
breaker.
Oh,
no!
So sad.
I also have plans, but I'll be playing a little bit.
I was worried it was going to be this last weekend because I had that stupid wedding to go to. And by stupid, I mean, if you're watching, congratulations. No, it was really a good time. It was just like, if it had been the weekend of Guild Wars 2, it would have been that stupid wedding. But in this case, it was awesome. It was a good time. So there's a couple other things I very briefly wanted to touch. For those of you that maybe watched the big lore show that we did or didn't, stupid advertisement, or maybe didn't watch the big lore show and wanted to get more information, this is by one of the best Guild Wars 2 YouTubers, I guess is the correct noun for it, out there right now. Wooden Potatoes is putting together
The World.
This is his first part of a many-part series talking about the lore, and he's going to talk about the entire story. If we look here at the end, if I find it, he actually has a roadmap of all the different things. Here we are. This is what he plans. He's got the world, then the Fall of Ascalon is going to be the next one, which is not out yet. The world is the first one that just come out. Then he's going to talk about the Magdar, the Chosen, the Flame Seekers, the Destroyers, the Great Dwarf, the 250 years in between, and then finally what's going on, I guess, right now in Guild Wars 2. Maybe he'll talk about the Ghosts of Ascalon. Anyway, if you want to get more in-depth even than we did on the big lore show, or maybe you just don't have time, this is a video that's like 9 minutes long, 10 minutes long, and it'll tell you everything you need to know about the Tyrian world. It'll really get you caught up to speed. So I highly recommend checking that out. Show notes are going to be at at talesoftyria.com. And if you're watching this on the YouTube, they're right in the description there as well. So last up, we have Freelancer. I believe you wanted to give us a recap of the Frag World Town Hall meeting.
Yeah, I just wanted to give a quick shout out and a special thanks to Trigger Pappy for throwing another awesome town hall meeting with all the guilds. I believe we're going to throw yet another one in either July or maybe a little past July. Hopefully by that point we would have already been in the game. You know, we'll see. Here's the hoping. But We went over a lot of great topics. We talked about the World v. World as a spectator sport topic. We talked about tournaments, the Team Legacy Structured PvP tournament that I'm getting everybody in to be kind of a community collaborative effort. A lot of great feedback on that, on how to structure that, what everybody wants to see from that. In general, just brought up a ton of great feedback with how World v. World was, everybody's clipping issues. And the most important thing, what makes it just important altogether, and you may be thinking, oh, no big deal, just an average conversation, is that ArenaNet was listening in on this. They were much, they were very finely, you know, keen on picking up little things on the last meeting. I guarantee they were even more so this meeting. So these meetings were very important because they got to see a side of things that they don't normally see, which is a discussion among nothing but guild leaders, talking about their experiences of their entire guilds in both structured PvP and the tournament scene. So I'm sorry, structured PvP and World v. World. So it was great altogether. I highly encourage everybody listening, if you're part of a guild, encourage your guild leaders to attend the next one. It is run by fragworld.net, and it is fragworld.com or .net. Try both, but and you can't miss it. The site's awesome.
fragworld.com.
And the site's awesome. Sign up with your guild there. Hopefully see you guys next time. I'm sure ArenaNet will be listening in, and I guarantee that there's somebody listening right now that has better ideas than I do, and that's what I want to encourage those people to step forward and join in on this conversation. That's all.
All right, I'm looking for the link right here, because I tried fragworld.net and fragworld.com, and neither worked.
Site might be down right now.
Might be. Guild Wars 2 Community Town Hall. That was the first one. Maybe there's a link on the first one I can find it. Maybe I'll put it in the show notes. I will put it in the show notes for you guys. Don't worry about that. Let's see. We'll move on to the last little bit, which is the mailbag. And we're actually at, what, an hour and 15 minutes here? So we're a little bit over time. But I do want to respond to what we were getting. Why doesn't this thing change? I tried to change the stupid scene a long time ago. We had a lot of people asking about a community guild for the Tales of Tyria community. A lot of people are saying, well, I don't have a guild. I don't know how to get into a guild. I don't have any friends that are playing. Are you going to do a guild? Or they just wanted to play with us, and they wanted to play with Team Legacy. We got a lot of requests about that, and we are working on it right now. So just stand by. Hopefully later on this week we'll have more information, and we'll release it on the YouTube channel. All the regular... Hey, I know you want to talk about it now, but we can't talk about it now. It's still being discovered. We're developing it. We don't have all the details yet. They want to release it right now. They want to tell you guys all the details that we don't have in place yet. So, you know, that's why they're the producer and I'm the host. So let's just stand by. If you want to really pay attention to this, keep track of the... Overseer Cat just got booted.
He actually, you know, the funny thing is, Bridger, he actually heard your birds and started freaking out.
Really?
Yeah. So
it's like, I'm hungry.
Oh, snap. That was hilarious.
When he gets in that mood, when he hears birds, his claws come out and they're right in my legs. And
I'm sorry. They just like to hear me talk. Anyway, so yeah, we'll be discussing that more. Keep an eye on talesoftyria.com. Keep an eye on the first place it's going to be probably is going to be on the YouTube channel. So if you want, subscribe to that, and you'll get like instant email access or whatever you set it up. And I'll also put a note out on the audio feed of the podcast there. So that's the answer to that. I'm sorry we don't have more details for you right now. We're still working on it. So we'll talk more about that later.
Yeah, we have to be very careful because servers do have caps and people do not like login times or queue mm-hmm. times. And we have to, you know, as cool as it may sound like to hang out with Vega and his sexy mug, we have to consider the fact that it may not be so fun when you have to wait 1 hour to log in.
Yeah.
So we'll get back to you guys on that.
Absolutely. So
I threw up a little bit by you calling me sexy.
Oh no. All right. We had some more mailbag here, but we've gone long enough. I think I'm gonna save these for the next week, maybe. We'll talk about it. Let's see. Yeah, these are some really good questions, and I do want to get to them, but we'll save these for next time. I think that's about wraps it up here, guys. Did we miss anything else, I guess?
I think we beat balance discussion to death.
Yeah, I think we definitely talked about that enough. We'll talk more about actual classes and class balance after the next beta. What I'm going to do is I'm actually looking to talk to specifically a lot of the sort of structured PvP specialists in Team Legacy and see if we can't get specific ones on to talk about specific classes. Because obviously, right now, I don't feel qualified to talk about anything except maybe the Elementalist, because that's how I spent all of my time. I can't tell you about the Ranger. I didn't study the Ranger. I studied the Elementalist. So what I'm going to try to do is get, like, the Ranger, and Freelancer can talk about the Mesmer. We're going to have Vega here to talk about the Engineer. And Oku plays something... I don't know. He's not coming back. So we'll do a lot more really in-depth discussions about the various classes and balance and things like that, and how to play the class and how they do play after the next beta, because I feel like we'll be closer to the launch in terms of how they're finally going to come together in terms of how their traits are set up and everything. And we'll have a lot more experience when we go through a whole other beta weekend event. So look forward to that. And remember that next weekend's Guild Wars 2 beta weekend is until the 10th, so we will not have our actual show until Monday the 11th. So with that, I think we will have to go out swinging.
Throwing it out there real quick, it is fragworld.org.
Oh, that's the one that I didn't try.
And that is my mistake. I've been on there like 20 times this week, and I kept wanting to say .com, but it is fragworld.org. Awesome site and doing an awesome thing for the community.
So the last thing I wanted to mention before we go is, remember, if you are stuck somewhere and you can't play the game, you can always watch us. Just go to teamlegacy.net. There is sort of a group of streamers there, including myself. I'll be streaming on my Bridger 15 account, so I know a lot of people are watching here on the Tales of Tyria one, but I'm only going to use the Tales of Tyria stream for official casts and official, like, matches that we're covering as a show, or if we're doing special events inside the game. When I'm just streaming by myself, when I'm playing with Team Legacy, when I'm playing by myself with my friends, whatever, it'll be on the Bridger 15 account, twitch.tv/Bridger15. Freelancer has his account. I think Vega has. Do you have an account yet, Vega? Are you streaming?
I do, but I'm not that good at streaming.
I know that Oku is streaming a lot.
You know what this means, Bridger? We have to have a streaming show.
Yes,
talk about basically getting everybody out there streaming. I mean, how awesome would it be if we encouraged just 100 more people to stream Guild Wars 2? That right there is a win.
I think what we're going to do is we'll probably save that for the next time we have a dearth of information and not really much to talk about, and or after the thing launches, because once the game is more optimized, people will be able to know whether or not they will be able to stream. Like, you and I can stream because we have the beefiest of beefy computers, but there will probably be other people out there that can stream, but not right now. Like, maybe once it's more
optimized. You'd be surprised. I can get anybody with a 1 meg upload at a decent stream. Guarantee it. When we have that episode, it'll be interesting.
All right, we'll definitely do something like that. So, I guess with that, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to go. In the most awesome way possible. Thank you, Bajord. Have a good night, everybody.
Night.
Night.
Oku almost
took me long enough to pull out the actual guitar.
Yeah. That's awesome. What did you... Oh, he's holding up the GeForce 670 just to make people feel bad. Joke's on him, though. He only has one monitor right now because of that monster.
I got one, too.
Oh, man, I feel like the only cool...
Oh, it's green. It's not see-through.
But, yeah, I pushed the 670 in that last meeting. Got myself another one, and I actually convinced myself to get another one. It was pretty bad. But
what do you mean another one? You have two 670s now?
I do now, yep. And actually, I got my...
I thought you said SLI is no. I can't hear
you. Well, That's, yeah, actually, this is the cool thing about this headset. PC360, by the way, Sennheiser. I got it with my new sound card. And this headset, which I didn't realize it until I was talking for like 20 minutes straight, realizing nobody could hear me in TeamSpeak, mutes when I do.
Yes.
Oh.
The coolest thing ever. So when I go to take
Mine
my headset
too.
Off,
I really like
and I have push to talk, or if, you know, if I'm in vent, I usually have like voice activation. I just can go like.
Nice.
Wife aggro comes by, you know. I just...
Now all we have to do in order to stop Freelancer from talking is sneak into his house and silently ninja pull his thing back, and he'll never know. He'll just keep talking. Maybe the cat will do it for us. We can train the cat.
Speaking of which.
Cue the cat to walk across the screen. Awesome. Where's Lonnie when we need him? So yeah, I can't believe you got two 670s. That's ridiculous. But you said you're having a problem because it's only got HDMI. It's got one DVI and then three HDMI port outs.
Yeah, well, what? I have two. What? I have two HDMI outs now. But yeah, the problem was, all right, I have three monitors, right?
Oku for president.
And this was like a noob mistake, right? This is I was ashamed of myself. All right, three monitors, three DVI inputs. Graphics card only has one DVI output, so I actually have to go get an HDMI adapter because my monitors are old. I need new monitors. I want to get one of those little 120 hertz monitors. Have you ever seen those?
No. What do you mean little?
Yeah. Well, you know, 24-inch 120 hertz monitor. If you've ever seen one in action, like, they're amazing. I couldn't believe it until I saw one at I think it was Best Buy, and I moved the mouse across it, and it's like unreal about the clarity of it because it's running at twice the, you know, the refresh rate.
Mm-hmm.
You'll never believe it until you see it. It was quite interesting.
Interesting. All right.
I'm really curious about those because, you know, I play a lot of like fighting games and stuff where the, you know, the input delay, which input delay is something that most hardware people don't know nothing about, and it's something that most people ignore, but I'm really curious how they perform as far as input delay. Input delay, you know, being not refresh rate.
Mm-hmm. Input delay, huh? I don't know.
Yeah, you guys didn't really talk. I was kind of white knighting in the chat.
Input delay in terms of, you mean like mouse?
Yeah. So basically, user input, how long that takes to show up on the screen. Yeah.
Oh, I see what you're saying. So, with regards to the monitor specifically.
Right. So, like a CRT is famous for having no input delay at all. But every LCD, because an LCD actually cannot display an image very clearly.
You're talking about the response time, like the 2 to 5 second response time?
No, response time is how long it takes to clear an image. Mm-hmm. So that's how quickly it can change the image. Input delay is how long it takes from the user to the screen. And so LCD monitors, every single one, especially TVs, they're not able to create a very crisp picture. So part of designing an LCD monitor is that you have a long series of post-processing. And every step of that series adds input delay, which is why you might notice if you plug in your PC to like HDMI on your TV, you might notice the mouse moves really slowly. That's an indication of high input delay. So usually when you go to like the VGA input on your TV, they remove some of the post-processing, and then you have less input delay.
The more you know.
Learn something new every day.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I actually didn't really know anything about this, and you know, I started playing fighting games, not, you know, competitively, but seriously, and it's a huge deal.
That's why they use CRTs.
Games.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember seeing them set up a fighting game tournament here. I think it was Evo 2006 or 5 or 4 or something,
right.
And they had all CRT monitors everywhere, and I was like, what's going on here?
Well, it's so funny because now, now they don't even, monitor designers don't even talk about it. So what the fighting game community's done now is basically they did a group effort of testing, and they all agreed on a certain model, a very specific model of Asus monitor, and then everyone was like, okay, everyone uses that monitor. Even if it has delay, everyone uses it, so learn that monitor. That's what's going to be at every tournament, and that's how it is.
Yeah,
because
I guess you get used to
monitor.
A specific amount of input delay.
Right.
Huh. Fascinating.
Interesting.
Sorry.
No, I'm really. That's not sarcastic. I.
Try it out. What you can do is, if you have a CRT, try playing a game on the CRT and then play it on the LCD. I bet you notice a difference. I did it even with Quake. I'm very familiar with Quake, and My mind was blown. I was like, wow, how did I not notice this before?
Voltaire says, when you're on high input delay, that equals SWTOR.
All right. I need to go watch Game of Thrones before someone ruins it for me.
So there you go. All right. Yeah, we'll cut the stream here, guys. We got things to do and people to see.
All right. Yeah. Have a good night, everyone.